Hello, and welcome to SkillingWorks. I'm John Uriarte, curator of SkillingWorks with a photographer's gallery in London. Together with Marco de Mutis, digital curator at Photomuseum Winterthur in Switzerland, we created this series of fortnightly live stream events looking at visual network cultures. SkillingWorks started almost 4 years ago, in April 2020, to continue with the ongoing engagement of both institutions with the changing role of photography in digital cultures. We invite artists, researchers, curators, and practitioners to take over our screens and share them with their ideas, their technologies, and their work processes, and their artistic practices as well. The format of each event changes, and it can range from a practical tutorial, a peek behind the scenes of a particular work, participatory exploration, or a live performance, always encouraging our guests to experiment with what the live stream event format can offer. We have hosted more than 70 events so far. You can watch the recordings of all of them for free on our website, skinworks.com. And on our YouTube channel, browsing among them through the tags that we've used to group and curate them. Please remember that if you have found SkillingWorks useful for your professional or personal interest, you can subscribe to folders. For 7 euros, you'll support the program and its artists, and also get your personalized folder on folders.skinworks.com. There you will receive files and extra content from the artists and researchers from SkillingWorks. And finally, some housekeeping information. Your microphone should be muted to avoid noise disturbances. If it's not, please turn it off. And we are recording and we will be archiving this event. You are free to use the public chat to ask any questions that you might have, and also send private messages to Marco or to me.
And hello from me too. I'm Marco de Mutis, digital curator at Photomuseum Winterthur. And today I'm excited to introduce a screen work that will take us inside a somehow playable interactive essay. Specifically, we'll be guided through one work that is part of a series of video game essays that Kat Bluemke and Jonathan Carroll, also known as SpekWork Studio, have developed around the Assassin's Creed game franchise. By critically exploring how representation and simulation of the past is created through the computer games from the series, the artists provide insight into contemporary social and political tensions. Assassin's Creed has famously taken players from Renaissance Italy to French Revolution, from ancient Greece to 19th century Norway, representing history through technology that might limit our ability to learn from the past and reimagine the future. And today we'll focus on one of the very core notions in image making and imaging, linear perspective. So in their game essay, Blindspot, Kat and Jonathan will take us to the digital simulation of Renaissance Florence, investigating what prevented the birthplace of linear perspective from being rendered in 3D. The omission of the Florentine Baptistery becomes a starting point for an inquiry into the site's importance in the development of Western scientific technology and the gradual restructuring of political power through such technological representation that continues to this day. Kat Bluemke and Jonathan Carroll are digital artists who specialize in game design, expanded reality, and performance. United under their collective persona as SpekWork Studio, they make experiences that span the digital spectrum from interactive games and comics to immersive reality experiences and live performances. These projects probe technology's ability to obscure the lines between work and play. They explore technology's duality as both a labor-saving device and tool of exploitation. Their works often engage with the struggles of precarious and feminized workers, the demographic that often finds itself at the crossroad of technological advances and pitfalls. They draw inspiration from their lives as precarious digital freelancers while learning from their communities and the oppressive system they seek to unravel. Recently, they're focusing on the ways work imprints upon our bodies and health by drawing on personal histories. With 10 years of exhibition history, they've shown internationally with prominent institutions like Rhizome and the New Museum and the Venice Architecture Biennale as part of the American Pavilion's corollary exhibits. Recently, they've exhibited with the Singapore Art Museum, Art Gallery of Regina, the Art Gallery of Grand Prairie, and other venues. With the support of the Canada Council of the Arts, Rhizome, and multiple provincial arts councils, the pair has self-published much of their interactive work online, making them freely available to a global audience. Finally, we would like to thank Matteo Bittanti at the Milan Machinima Film Festival and Viral, which is where we had the chance to discover the wonderful work of SpekWork. If you are interested in game art, in game photography and machinima, go and subscribe to their newsletter and support them through their Patreon if you have the chance. So yeah, big thanks to Matteo and everything that he's doing over there. The commitment and quality of their work is simply unparalleled. All right, now enough of me talking. Kat and Jonathan, thank you so much for being with us today. The screen is yours.
Thank you so much, Marco and John. Thank you as well. And shout out to Matteo too from us. It was great to have that opportunity to show another project within our Assassin's Creed art history overall project, as well as to get an opportunity to then talk about this work, Blindspot, as part of this presentation. So we have a video game essay to show you, and our first off, my name is Jonathan Carroll. Hello.
And I'm Kat Bluemke.
Maybe I'll start us off by bringing us into the video game essay that we're going to show you. Then we'll kind of watch it so that there's context for the things we're going to talk about. So I'm just going to be taking us through a tour of this and listening to the audio that presents the content of the essay, as well as interacting with some of the elements within the video game essay. And then after that, it's about 6 minutes long. We'll talk to you a bit more about this project, as well as the specifics within this piece. So I'm going to just turn on my screen share right now. We have all of our projects generally available on our website, which is spekwork. That's SpekWork. You can find us as well on itch.io, which is where a lot of our video games are freely playable, either in browser or downloadable. So a lot of these things you can experience for yourself, which is one of the things we love about working with video games, but maybe more on that later. So I'm just going to hit run here and then silence myself and take you through this essay. Sorry, I'm muted. I have to unmute it. vamping.
Oh, the ceiling looks really nice.
Okay. Did you hear audio for a second there? Okay, cool. Let's go back in full screen. And here we go again.
The Piazza del Duomo of Florence, Italy, is one of the most popular tourist destinations in Europe. The striking combination of the marble-clad cathedral, bell tower, and baptistery has led to countless representations of the scene in paint, photography, and even video games. It was the Florentine baptistery that incited the development of a technology which would change the way we view and create representations forever. Its doors, named the Gates of Paradise, are often cited in Western art history as a catalyst in the revisioning of form which occurred during Italy's Renaissance. The gilded subjects displayed a naturalist dimension that distinguished them from the more popular symbolic representation of the period. But it was the dimensions of the baptistry itself that became the focus of experiments that would introduce the modern Western world to linear perspective. The architect Filippo Brunelleschi applied mathematics to the sensorial world, rationalizing human experience as preordained equations. Reproducing the baptistry in paint on a flat panel, he proved that this new technology could produce the illusion of mastery over nature. Although convincing, the illusion of perspective creates a selective map that projects the status of the Western viewer above their surroundings. Such technological development in Western history is coupled with the extraction of the natural world. In the extraction of images, the world is rendered as its anthropocentric use value. Our increasingly minute perceptions occur both at a microscopic level and as one-to-one computer simulations. As with the empire of the Borges fable, the faith in our methods of perception create an ontology through which everything must be drawn. These models extend through our experience of space and time, while multi-billion-dollar entertainment industries continue Brunelleschi's quest for high naturalism across a flat plane. In the 2009 action-adventure game, Assassin's Creed 2, the company Ubisoft recreated Brunelleschi's Florence using its architectural landmarks as gameplay mechanics. But in this simulated Florence, the Baptistery was missing. An empty piazza of NPCs stood in for the icon. The studio cited technological limitations for this reasoning. Was it the Baptistry's shiny bronze doors? Or the stress of an additional large textured model to the scene? Or did its weighty role as the representation of the Western gaze prevent its display? While some of their audience spoke out in disappointment of this blind spot, for many players of the 9 million copies sold, the game's representation of 15th century Florence was complete, a map made whole as a second order simulacra. The Assassin's Creed franchise hereby demonstrates what fits inside the frame of history for a 1.7 billion euro game company. When Paris's Notre Dame Cathedral caught fire in April 2019, a 3D model of the cathedral created for the fourth Assassin's Creed game began trending on social media. With millions of players having spent more time in its virtual representation than the smouldering stone monument, they suggested that the model could provide vital information for its reconstruction. This was less so praise to contemporary graphical representation, as the model in question had been significantly altered to promote gameplay, and rather revealed our subjugation within the empire of techno-capitalism. With history in the hands of international corporations, it is their map which precedes the territory. Today, it is the territory whose shreds slowly rot across the extent of the map. But the empire remains, whether represented in paint or pixels. The logic of perspective and its desire to render the sensorial world as sensical is drawn through both modern science and its pseudo-counterparts. The rationalization of human experience in turn measures the value of human life, placing it within a variable equation. Today, our modern nation-states maintain the profitable interests of techno-capital while millions die of a global pandemic. The giants that control information and distribution technologies have become pandemic profiteers. This includes the game industry, for whose representations of alternative worlds consumers spent an unprecedented 174 billion US dollars. And with this wealth comes the power to revision history, fact, and future. For the empire of techno-capital possesses the same imperialism to make the real, all of the real, coincide with their models of simulation. We are in view of a vanishing point, but where to draw the line?
I can also drop that link in the chat for folks who want to experience it with a little less lag, but the glories of technology. Note, it works best in Chrome. thanks, Jonathan, for walking us through. Shall we just unpin this video and pin us?
Yes. Here, I'll stop sharing.
Yeah. There we go. Yeah, so that is one of the many iterations of Blindspot, which has gone through sort of different formats over the past couple of years. Definitely sort of evolved as a pandemic project, as when we were trapped in isolation in a very cold area of Canada. in the wintertime, and has sort of taken on different formats as like the obsession with the Assassin's Creed series and its depictions of art history and just sort of world history or Western history as this obsession has grown. This is like the second in a series that we are calling the Assassin's Creed Art History series, that they're all this kind of video game essay in which we've explored a couple different strategies for employing what we call a video game essay, usually using Unity, but also integrating more linear formats, as was present in Blindspot, where you had kind of this video as a central focus, could play with elements of the video itself, and you're sort of situated inside where the video was filmed as well, like in the virtual, using virtual cameras, of course. We have some talking notes, and we'll just kind of swap off as we go through them, and also want to like show a couple of different versions of this series as well. I'm vamping still. Oh, okay.
The first project within the series that we worked on is called Game Workers and Guild Workers. Each project, like it's been said a couple of times, looks at the Assassin's Creed video game series and kind of uses different aspects of that series to ask questions about technology and the representation of history and what kind of stories are occluded or left out through those representations of history, and especially how those telling of those stories happens through technology. So in the first project we worked on Game Workers and Guild Workers, asked a question. The thesis of the project was, did the medieval guild workers who built Notre Dame Cathedral have better labor protection than the contemporary game workers who built the digital representation of Notre Dame Cathedral within the video game?
I'll just share that in the back, a muted video in the background while you discuss.
Cool. Do you have share? Okay, cool. Great. This was our first video game essay, and like an essay in text, we wanted it to have a thesis which is what I just stated, but then using the power of video games to perform something that is known in game studies as procedural rhetoric. We wanted to explore the thesis that we were expressing in this essay, not just through the content of the essay, which in this case is both visuals and audio. We have a narration reading out text that was written by us and then narrated by our friend Roman, not only through the narration, but also through the gameplay. So as you navigate through this space, kind of recreating the parkour mechanics of the Assassin's Creed series, you experience different aspects of the story that we want to tell through this essay appear, are generated through your navigation. Specifically, you're kind of prompted by these fires that appear in the distance. Now, of the kind of the original inspiration for this project was the burning of the cathedral, which is also mentioned in Blindspot. That was something of a catalyst for us to start thinking about Notre Dame Cathedral in general. But then I guess once the connection between the burning cathedral and the simulated cathedral in Assassin's Creed became clear, we got the idea to focus on looking at Assassin's Creed as this lens through which you can think about technology, history, and representations.
And it was interesting, these pieces sort of work, like they're over the pandemic being developed, and they are working with earlier games of Assassin's Creed. Of course, that entire franchise has emerged more, like developed their educational aspects of it now a bit more thoroughly to try to be more open to a broader audience, but we really found in these versions of the games that how it was very strict, especially with the second Assassin's Creed that Blindspot is focuses on and its depictions of Florence. It was super, super restrictive in what you could actually do for a good chunk of the game, and I loved how it was really taking you out of that immersion if I didn't, finish this quest or like follow this character, and therefore really did was creating this very limited scope of history that I could experience. Yeah, I think it would it's fun. Each of these series, if we end up finding ourselves back at the Notre Dame Cathedral, I think we're just we might maybe we're in love with the model or something. But it's something that we're yeah we return to with each of these video game essays, because just this moment in history when it was burning down and Ubisoft really wanted everyone to play the virtual version really stood out to us in this moment of in this weird sort of techno-feudal landscape that we found ourselves in like from 2019 onward throughout the pandemic.
Yeah, and the kind of the spoiler for it is that the game workers who built this cathedral lacked the protections that the relative to what the guild workers had in the Middle Ages building the real cathedral over a course of centuries. Instead, the because of the unorganized state of the video game industry, the game workers who work for Ubisoft build models like this are they're non-unionized. They lack the kind of safety in numbers and solidarity that would have been found in a medieval guild. In this case, the digital cathedral was built by one person, and it like we explored in the Blindspot video, as well as we look at it through these the prompts you can see on the screen in this game. The model from Assassin's Creed was not up to the task of standing in for the real life thing, as it was constructed for gameplay and not for realistic simulation. So one of the other in these projects, we are somewhat exploring the use of didactic materials in a bunch of different ways and how that can play into a video game, how you can express an idea through a video game in a way that is specific to the video game. That is more or less what the idea of procedural rhetoric is, like through exploring an environment that has in developing processes within it, whether they're simulated or through the interaction of the player, what kind of meaning can be specifically expressed well through those mechanics? You will we can look at the so we call this the Assassin's Creed art history project a triptych, because there are three video game essays that involved in it. The first one is Game Workers, Guild Workers. The second one is Blind Spot, which we watched. And then the third was the piece that we were lucky to present at the Milan Machinima Festival, which is called Crowd Control. And that uses the same Assassin's Creed as the one we were just watching, set in the French Revolution, but it looks at the use of crowd simulation, which the Assassin's Creed Unity game was well known for its use of crowd simulation to create the mobs of the French Revolution, being the goal of that technology. And there was a lot of hype about how they were able to create a horde of NPCs that could all be interacted with, non-player characters that could all be interacted with by the player. So our third video game essay in this series looks at the use of crowd simulations through not just through technology, but also through art history, and what representations of crowds, how representations of crowds are used to then also manipulate the will of crowds, or use crowds as a symbol for different meanings than what the crowd itself might want, or even to directly control the crowd itself.
So with this, yeah, with oops, yeah, great, awesome. Yeah, with the series, we're using a lot of the same tools to well we it was they were all sort of developed across Unity and with like video editing software, and you can see a kind of like the same mechanics being presented in different ways across the three pieces. There's like the pop-ups, essentially like the graphic using these graphics that you can interact with in the first two projects, and then become more of just like a something that the NPCs interact with for the final piece, kind of removing the audience's role in the final pieces. It's really focusing on kind of this the role of the NPCs as the crowd. But we were really interested in how there had been developing this kind of really standard video essay format that was often shown in galleries that we enjoyed. We enjoyed a lot of these pieces, especially the work of like Camille Lanrot's like Grosse Fatigue. We saw it in when we were students actually living in Florence for for a period studying art history there, and just seeing like the computer screen, the MacBook screen amplified and like glorified onto this big projection in the gallery was very exciting for us. And thinking about the screen as a site of like archive and how we experience the archives, both those that we create as well as like these more institutionalized archives, like museum websites, as the site of an abundance of information. But then of course, as we get to the later part of the 2010s, we're really seeing it also as the site of information distortion. And so we're thinking about that a lot with this series, because we're trying to heighten like that the audience's role in this type of information consumption. Like when you watch a video essay, which is very also now prominent on YouTube and such, there's the way that you digest it and you take it apart. So when we put a little video inside of a 3D model and then allow you to play with some of the parts of the video, we're really hoping that you feel a bit of agency with the kind of narrative that it's expressing, and thinking about the way that, you know, we're communicating something, but it's very much down to the audience and the way that they process this information, the way it's shared, that leads like to the actual message that comes across. Not necessarily like a death of the author thing entirely, but we're definitely thinking about how the added layer of interactivity brings new meaning to everything that we're interested in, because all of these projects came out of us playing too many video games and drawing many conclusions from them ourselves. So we'd like our audience to do the same thing with our projects. Jonathan, are you pulling up crowd control? Or,
yes, I am.
Yeah. Okay, sorry.
Here, I'll bring it up here. It's the courtesy of the Milan Machinima website, the Milan Machinima Festival website. So just looking at this briefly. Oh yeah. Would I mute it? Okay. So here again, you can see we're doing the same use of these didactic pop-ups, as we're calling them. In this piece, we shift from a first person perspective to a disembodied third person perspective. Again, this is meant to reference the topics of surveillance. That is like a prominent, that's one of the main ideas that we wanted to explore, the way that surveillance is achieved through art and representation of masses of people was one of the main things we wanted to explore within this piece. So the disembodied third person perspective does that. I'll just to say briefly about the production of these works, we use the assets from Assassin's Creed. There are some tools that people within the community have developed to extract models, textures, and sounds from the Assassin's Creed game. So we rip all that material, and then we kind of consider it to be an interactive digital collage, where we take all of that found material from the games themselves, bring them into a video game engine, which is a tool used for making video games. The one we use is called Unity. And we we reassemble all those assets to make these video game essays. So in the case of Game Workers Guild Workers, the cathedral from Paris. In this game, we have the streets of Paris, also from Assassin's Creed Unity. Of course, in the main piece we're talking about today, A Blind Spot, there is no baptistry within the Assassin's Creed 2 game. So we found a model of the baptistry online and used that, the whole point of that video being the lack of a baptistry. So we like to think of Blind Spot as being this, especially the interactive version of Blind Spot that we are exploring, to be a purgatorial space where the baptistry lives in its exclusion from the main game. Instead, this is the kind of nowhere zone where it lives instead. But otherwise, all of the sounds and models and textures are grabbed from the games themselves, save of course for the pop-ups, which in the case of this video, crowd control. It's really exploring different artistic representations of crowds of people throughout mostly the 18th and 19th century. Do you catch the images in crowd control here?
No, in Blind Spot.
Yes, maybe I'll head over back over to Blind Spot then, mm-hmm. so you can look at those images.
Mm-hmm. So then with the images that we chose to throw and that were to be actually interactive within this baptistry purgatory, these were, of course, a lot of things that... content that was captured through my screen as like playing within this genre of the video essay that's captured on the in the side of the screen, but then also a lot of like art history photos and photos from the more recent news. So we've got
They just disappeared, but they will come back again in a second. Because once the video, they pop the way the images function is they pop up as the video is playing. The video loops eventually, which is it's getting to the end of its loop now. So once it starts over again, then the images will reappear.
Mm-hmm. And the artists, many of them Italian, whose names of which I take some responsibility to say correctly because I did take that in the art history course, but pity me for I am a Canadian who lives way out in the boonies and I don't exactly get a chance to use my art history background very frequently. But of course we have, Jonathan, you're looking at the doors. You're looking at the Gavertis baptistry doors right now that are also not part of this model. So you have to use your imagination. But then it really starts, the graphics that we included focus on this. It starts with the focusing on the cathedral, the site of the Florence Duomo, the bell tower, and then the baptistry. Of course, the first two being featured in the Assassin's Creed game and the final one totally not. But these gates, of course, being this focus point for this experiment that's talked about in the or that's spoken of in the essay that accompanies like the written format portion, where the architect Filippo Brunelleschi, I knew I was going to do it. Observed the doors and the way that the structure of this baptistry existed in relation to the building behind it of the Duomo. He was able to see these lines emerge in the natural landscape and in the built environment. So he created an illustration moving back and forth between these two points, between the doors of the two different buildings, that was kind of like allowing him to capture this in from that vantage point and just grab it out of nature. And this, of course, comparative to the other Gothic styles where the natural world, if it was depicted, was often like the buildings or the backgrounds were, gold, heavily gold, and images of that also feature in this work as well, such as like the crucifix crucifixes from the Uffizi and other Gothic panels. Wow, yeah. It looks like you hit it really well, Jonathan.
These are randomly spawning images that I don't know why that appeared so far away. It's floating in the distance.
Well, it's using the Gothic method of hierarchical scale. So it's very important. It's placed very up high. I think that's what's going on here. And then we have a flipped version. That's funny. We're seeing it reverse. But we have more Renaissance artists who take this in the next 100 years are taking this technique of linear perspective and using it to depict the natural world in very controlled spaces. So really heightening the power that humans have to take over their natural environment and really bend it to their will. And then so the various images that are displayed, we have Pietro Perugino here, the delivery of the keys, where there's a really awesome looking scene that with an octagonal building in the center that I love, and then different types of depicting different kinds of bodies in spaces that are further from the viewer, therefore their scale is different. It's not just Jesus is the big important one, but then see the essay itself sort of brings you through kind of past the Renaissance and into the more Enlightenment and scientific era, into how those strategies of capturing the natural world come through through data collection with science in some in kind of fun ways, like in Hans Wiedemann de Vries, probably saying that wrong, in his perspective treatise, which is sort of which expands upon some of the earlier Renaissance models, but really and situates it for his time, where there's everything where he sees perspective as a way of perhaps going beyond the limitations. Yeah, I don't know what's going on here, but I love it so much. It really looks like a murder mystery. It really looks like a video game I want to play. So we have this engraving from his perspective treatise, and he thinks of using perspective and using the analysis of the world as a way in which you can escape the limitations of the actual world and bring yourself into something more fantastic, which I think is where we end up getting with video games, where we take measuring of the world and then its replication in 3D environments through 3D engines, through modeling, and even data. Data visualization, which is then expressed through the later graphics in Blindspot, where we're looking at how many video games did everybody play in 2020? Well, this is really, look at this number, it's really high. Gee, I wonder what percentage of that is me. And then also of course on the dark end of things, the science of the bogus science of phrenology, where it's just trying to take a particular mode of data collection in order and then presenting it in a way that is to prop up an oppressive regime of racism in this case. So there's Petrus Camper's illustrations there, who was trying to use skull measurements to indicate a racial hierarchy. Which I came through an essay by Martin Kemp, who's an art historian who also wrote extensively on the Renaissance. So all these kinds of graphics are things that were discovered discovered by me, brought into this space through my interactions on the screen while in lockdown mostly, and compiling giant folders of different screenshots and screen recordings of how we were experiencing these spaces, visualizations of these spaces from far away, And then putting them all within this virtual space just felt like a useful conclusion for something, the question that had kept me up at night for so long, which was that that really mind-bending question of was the Florence Baptistery omitted from Assassin's Creed because it was so important for Western art histories, the history of perception and linear perspective. I was so excited when we finally published this ish, and I'm like, I can step back from this for a moment. Please, no more.
And working some more of the technical kind of this harmony between the technical aspects of making a video game and the content of this essay are pretty obvious, where video games wouldn't exist without the idea of linear perspective. That's how you have things like those images that were appearing very far away. That's how you're able to create that illusion, is through the idea of perspective. So thus the irony inherent to leaving out the structure that helped to bring in bring about the advent of the idea of linear perspective in art. So that is the reason why it seemed obvious to us that it was a good topic to explore through a video game. A video game and linear perspective in general, as is explored in this essay, it privileges the individual viewpoint, because you need a single point of view for a perspective to be linearly represented. And of course, a first person video game like we're experiencing now, and like the Assassin's Creed is in a way, although technically it's third person looking at a character, but still from one single vision viewpoint looking out onto a space represented linearly. All of that also plays into the kind of the individual at the heart of things like the development of the Enlightenment, and this kind of subjectivity that's enhanced by those technologies that Kat was talking about, whether it's linear perspective or the more insidious ones that are also like tied into the idea of empire and the creation of some of the bad things associated with that. That's all inherent in the video game technology as well, where you have this single point of view. A funny way that's expressed in this game, all the images are flipped because I programmed something in so that the images would always face you, turn towards you to look at you. You can see it kind of working there.
It has nothing to do with legality. Absolutely nothing.
With legality? No. I just wanted the images. It's a technique called billboarding, where you make a flat image face the camera, but I screwed it up so that it actually makes the back of every image face you. That's why they're all the artwork is backwards. I'm not as versed in art history as Kat is, so like that it doesn't appear as wrong to me as it does to her. But that's on me, the backwardsness. I have to change something so it's like make the front of the thing face the camera.
It's not just so that the AI scraping Ubisoft's AI scraping looking for like copyright infringement doesn't flag us, but maybe it has kept us safe and we don't even know. This has been a really interesting series to sort of explore the same versions of these questions over and over again. Sometimes we've been asked when presenting these works about Ubisoft's role, like commenting on Ubisoft's role in education as they've expanded kind of their franchise of Assassin's Creed to be more open world and to provide and actually brought on loads, even though they have done this in the past with these games that we were discussing in these pieces. There were like art historians as kind of consultants brought onto these games, but they're really stressing the the potential for their more recent games to be used in like a classroom setting. And when asked to what we think about this, so perhaps we're anticipating a Q&A session, who knows, if you have a question, we're open to answering. When asked about like the more contemporary Assassin's Creed games, it's like the same questions still come to us, basically like how can we sort of consider the role of like this multi-million dollar company whose primary role is to like make money for its investors, is to sell games. How can we think critically of the kinds of information that they're providing us as like truth and as types, as like the kind of history that we want to focus on, and what, like in this case, what might we be missing because it's not fun or it's not interesting, or it might just be outside of the scope of a video game company rather than an art history textbook. Although I definitely have played around in their educational, in the educational mode or exploration mode of the more recent Assassin's Creed games, and been very grateful that I could, explore rather than be really held to following my my like mission, which really that's not the kind of game I want to play. I want to be a bird. That's more up my alley. What kinds of history are we still telling? Like, are we still being forced to believe through these companies? And that's what, Blindspot is really still that the manifestation of our obsession with that.
And on that note, thank you so much from my side, and I invite, of course, everybody to ask their questions in the chat. In the meantime, John and I have lots of questions for you. We've been like chatting in the back channels during the talk all the time. I think you raised a lot of interesting questions in us. John, do you want to start, or do you want to say something?
I just wanted to say thank you too. I mean, I'm happy to start with some of the questions. One of the things that Marco and me were talking about is about this idea of a playable essay, which we find quite refreshing, and also intriguing, and also like the we feel like there's a lot to explore in this format. And one of the things that we were talking about exploring is like the playability and how far the playability of playable essay can be. And I guess without losing the storyline that you want to suggest, that you want to introduce, no, what would be like the limit of like how far it could be explored? And if you have ever thought on making it like more interactive, or I don't know, like which will be the limit for you?
Yeah. I'm definitely interested in finding that, what that limit might be. There's this idea in game design, the best video game design word, it's ludonarrative dissonance or ludonarrative harmony. And it's like ludo is games and then narrative. So the idea is like in a conventional video game, how much does the gameplay reinforce the story that you're trying to tell? For instance, a lot of games, you're supposed to be a good guy, but you go around killing people. So it's like that's a kind of the most basic example of ludonarrative dissonance. You're trying to tell a story of a hero, but that hero's job is to murder people. I like to think of, so I just, in working on these projects, I've been thinking about the idea of ludo rhetorical narrative dissonance or harmony. So like, how much does the gameplay reinforce the rhetorical message, the argument that you're trying to make? And the more interactive, or yes, when these games that we've made, these three games are very linear in so far as by video game standards. They're not overly simulational. They're more so more or less linear experiences that unfold through the player's interaction. But they for the most part, unfold in the same way. The main different one is the crowd control project, where that's basically just a crowd simulation that you are witnessing, and it's going to be different every time you watch it. But that doesn't really affect the meaning of the project itself. But the way I'd like to think of future video game essays is either going. Focusing on how do you find that harmony between the gameplay and the rhetoric, or else how can you use the idea of maybe ludo-rhetorical dissonance in an interesting way. How could you make gameplay that challenges the argument that you're going to make, perhaps, or give the player the option to choose different strategies? Maybe actually a good, I'll just show co-op copter for a second, Kat. Yeah, so
well, Jonathan's finding those projects. I'll talk. We have two projects that we did before this series, which are really gamey projects. One was a mobile game about escape from the gig economy, about where you have a shitty main storyline, but then you can explore this back narrative, which is about unionizing over the company app, but then most of their time is spent just in this really thankless tap game, and it's for phones. So it was thinking about gig economy apps and enduring monotony, and with that we are really it was developed while I was in graduate school and researching about this, and really was hoping that people would, stick around for the whole game and actually survive through their first day in order to get to the kind of more the parts where you can actually understand that there's unionizing going on behind the scenes. But we for to kind of how far playability can get in this context is if people have lost the first round, they wouldn't get to this secondary screen. They wouldn't get to this other part of the game where you learn about this whole world that's unfolding. So that was a big challenge after, doing a lot of user testing with people who are really involved in games. And then we release it to a gallery audience and people are just quit, giving up after they lose the first few times, and we realized we did make it a little easier, but then also what are people getting if they don't like games, or if they just don't like this type of game, so we did kind of apply the same strategies in different mode. So we have now, this isn't a mobile game, this is just something you can run on the browser, but this is a game that we developed during when we were living in that very cold winter during early 2020, but before the lockdowns in the prairies of Canada, and there was a lockout strike going on with a oil refining plant there in town, and they'd locked out the workers who had been complaining about safety standards, which is very important, and they'd been flying helicopters over the city, where we could hear them every day. They've been flying scab workers over the picket line to process the oil. And so in this game, which we made as part of Global Game Jam with a bunch of other folks in the same city who contributed voice acting and modeling and graphics and such, you could choose to do as you were told, which was to fly the strike workers over the picket line, or you could drop them off in front of the picket line and they'd join the Scabby the Rat inflatable here, and they would sing the Internationale all together, and you'd have a different kind of win state. But it was something that we didn't explicitly, there was no instructions for that situation. There was only the instructions of your radio capitalist guy telling you through chewing a cigar, and you got to get these workers to the plant stat. So there was a hidden message that was revealed through gameplay, but only if you'd played it in a certain way. So again, kind of struggling with, we have these messages that we want to make available through the games, but you have to have a certain level of video game literacy in order to find them out, which is when we really started playing with the more linear style that we ended up going with for the Assassin's Creed Art History series.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I was thinking, there was this moment during Blindspot that to me was very cathartic. Maybe it's like the moment when Jeff Bezos appears next to the Baptistery, you know, it's like, and suddenly like, wait, what's happening? But it's exactly what you guys said about like this idea of corporations that are behind these 3D models and this telling and narration of the past and art history being somehow in the hands of this. And I think, also here at SkreenWorks, we've seen so many different like image technologies that are coming out, you know, even like latest like generative AI platforms. They're all coming out from corporations, right? And not so much from cultural institutions or with, you know, like an artist or knowledge worker, let's say, at the heart of it. So I was just wondering, one question would be, you seem to try to do the opposite, right? Like you try to take the game and reappropriate it and say, no, as artists, we can actually go the other way around. And I was wondering, what is the state of game art games and game art in your own experience? You know, many of the like some of the examples that you show also remind me of like Paolo Pedercini and all of this like a genre of indie gaming that were political or are still, but I just don't know. It would be interesting to hear your opinion about what do you think this movement, this genre or this medium, what is the state of it in your experience now?
We love Paolo.
Definitely. Paolo's games are made under the moniker Molli Industria are like that's the originator of this form of political video games in our mind, at least that for us personally, like when we saw Paolo's games, when we just first started getting into making games, it was very inspiring for us because they are games that perform procedural rhetoric, that are used to look at ideas of labor exploitation, resource extraction, all these things that we also like to explore in our games. And I think that he has gone on to inspire a lot of other people to make games with that kind of content as well. The most exciting thing with games right now for me is around labor organization within games. Here in Canada, especially, there are a lot of initiatives to start video game co-ops. We were mentioning and talking about the Game Workers Guild Workers project, the building of the digital cathedral being done by ununionized, unorganized workers. Like that's changing quite a bit, even though it's also part of that is because it's so bad in the games industry. It's kind of at the point where for workers, something has to change because it has gotten so bad. And so one thing that's happening is efforts towards unionization. There's an organization called Game Workers United that does that kind of thing. And then there's also, like I was saying, here in Canada, there's a lot of video game cooperatives that are opening. And then a lot of those organizations have some impetus to make games that have a rhetorical aspect to them in terms of like somehow espousing the meaning behind why you would want to start a cooperative, which is to like work more in a more equitable context. So those sorts of organizations have the potential to make some interesting projects that I would say, if we're thinking of video game art, are more just on the side of being video games. Whereas for I think of Paolo's work as being art as well as also really good games, obviously. But I think there's other video game makers who don't think of their craft as being objects that are meant to be shown in galleries, which is that's the excuse we give to our families, but why we don't make any money off of our video games. It's because, oh, they show in galleries. That's
speaking of which, maybe you want to mention, I know that you have a new game project in the pipeline that can also be wishlisted on Steam. I don't know if you mention it, if you want to like show it.
Yes, I would love that.
I wanted to mention this as well, because this is a conversation we had, Marco, but the state of the state of art games is really interesting in Canada, because we did have a number of organizations like the Hand Eye Society, like Games Art International Assembly. Like there's a lot of organizations that started in Canada to support like experimental video game work. And also, and like Jonathan said, it's attracting people that maybe didn't come out of art school and like had these skills, but didn't necessarily think that they were like producing art, but then was really given like a vocabulary in which to create their work and have it appreciated. Now, oh yeah, and this is a great time where I can say thank you, Canada Council for the Arts, for supporting the Assassin's Creed Art History Series, which I think was benefited my receiving of funds from the Canada Arts Council, because there was also a linear version of some of the videos that they could watch for the jury, because you don't know who's ever seeing your work in those contexts. But we are seeing in Canada a big reduction in funding for the on the side of like games and or like digital art, and we just had a big pool of money that's been sort of keeping Jonathan and I alive through our little like drips that we've been able to get just dry up. So at the end of this year, so there, it's an interesting time to be making these kinds of projects in Canada, as we have a couple really conservative political movements that are gaining a lot of steam. And while they're actually like very, you know, there's a lot of other problems with these governments outside of like experimental art game funding, like, you know, threatening trans lives and such. We're talking about a lot of funding that has so far like really fostered this amazing scene that Jonathan and I have been privileged to be a part of, and are instead like focusing kind of more on just like commercial funding. So this new game that Jonathan was popping up, we have actually been trying to take some of our games that have been funded initially with like initial like mechanics or tools or models we like were able to make for projects through arts funding. We've been forced to kind of pivot and see if we can throw them up on the online Steam store with a bit more interactivity, a bit more kind of standard fun mechanics to play, still with like the message at the in the back, but now we charge, you know, like $5 for it or whatever.
Still, most of our games on it, or all of our games on itch, are free.
Yes, that's true.
This is our first attempt at making something that we might be able to. Kind of like to the what you were talking about, John, having enough gameplay in it that it feels more like a video game to people, and maybe enough to treat it like a commercial product.
And in fact, related to this and to commercial games, I was thinking, so Assassin's Creed has all this like relationship and all these images, all these like models from art history that gives, I think it takes some sort of like authority, even if it is like a aesthetic authority or a certain canon, visual canon, while maybe the latest games, like mainstream games that seem, I don't know, I feel like they seem to go more into like trendy or like viral images. I'm thinking on the latest GTA or like Cyberpunk even. So I don't know if you feel like this, if you agree with me, or maybe I'm missing. I'm not so much into gaming, I have to admit. So I might be missing some big games, but is it true that like this authority of like art history that maybe was more present in even in gaming years before is not there anymore? Is that something that you think, or is there any other new game that has used also like art history, like famous or big influential art history images on their game making?
You should definitely play Pentiment if you're interested.
Yeah, there's definitely smaller games that are, yeah, but I think Assassin's Creed kind of has the market cornered in the like AAA space, like in terms of the biggest games that deal with history and that have these explicit representations of history inside of it. There's not really anything else besides Assassin's Creed. And I would bet that you're like kind of right where in this is like, I feel like this is not going to be a well thought out analogy, but it makes me think of just the in AI generated content, AI generated images, where eventually we're getting to this point already where it's AI recycling other AI things into new AI stuff. I kind of see that as maybe the Grand Theft Auto, Cyberpunk are these kind of just recycling these simulacra of already, Cyberpunk being just a recycling of imagery based on Blade Runner, or Grand Theft Auto just being a recycling of itself versus having a referent in the real world. Yeah, I would bet that there's some that maybe an interesting video game essay there.
Yeah, it's interesting now that we've had like more than 10 years of Assassin's Creed. We've had more than so many AAA studios really like cement their place in a certain kind of story, a certain kind of narrative or mechanic, and it also like a certain level of graphics. And I think this is something that we've also encountered as artists working in this field, like obviously not being having access to the same either like labor force because it's just the two of us, or like hardware, or like our audience doesn't have that hardware either. So if we're making if we're using these assets, we're using like a really stripped down version of them. We're using or we remove all the textures in order to run it on the browser, et cetera, et cetera. The people have come to, or at least like a lot of mainstream game players have come to like expect from, I think, like a history game that you have this like really, beautiful version of history that can immerse you in the situation. Kind of like maybe how, HBO, you want to watch a history show from it, or like some sort of historical drama from HBO because it's like going to look so good because the budget's so high. But yeah, it's interesting with what you say with the kinds of like viral, like seeking viral like meme status almost coming out of these games, because definitely I see when I'm like watching people like play games on Twitch or something, they're also kind of hoping to find the next like glitch that makes their particular run through of the game famous, or the way that we're encountering these images of history so far removed for so many different purposes, and they're all of course being driven by like attention economy, like monetization in the end for YouTube. So it's like, or Amazon, Elon Musk, yeah. It's really quite, it's really interesting to see the way in which like the games are being made about all sorts of different topics, and still like the kind of ways in which they get popular are all very similar.
Wonderful. So on that note, I think that if there is no question, no burning last question from anyone, I would thank you once again, and thank everybody who joined on Zoom and on Twitch. And we're gonna be back in 2 weeks again with SkrinWorks.
Yeah, thank you from my side too. We will be back in 2 weeks. It's on, I think, 17th of April with no data fetch. So we invite you all to come back. Thank you so much, Jonathan and Kat, for a really interesting screen work. I enjoyed it really a lot, and I'm gonna be looking forward for your next game too. So thank you.
Much appreciated.
Much
Thank you,
appreciate
everybody.
it. Thank you so much.